So this is a nice song. You must have heard Srila Prabhupada sing it. Often the devotees don't sing it themselves. We hear Prabhupada sing it, but we don't know it. So you please try to learn. We have some Vaishnava song books also, isn't there?
Yes.
It would be easier for you if you see the Vaishnava song book. The screen's a little far away. So anyway, this song on the life of the six Goswamis, describing the activities of the Goswamis, Acharya, and Srinivas Acharya, Goswami. And so here are the activities in this in the book. Krishna Kirtana
Yeah.
Thank you.
Teachings are very significant for us. We, our Krishna consciousness movement is based on the teachings of Rupa Goswami. We note, for example, in some of the pranam mantras to some of our Gaudiya Vaishnava acharyas, they're described to be Rupanuga, followers in the footsteps of Srila Rupa Goswami. So many people worship Krishna. Just like I remember some people came from China and they told me they were going to Kuala Lumpur. So I told them, well, you must go to the temple. So they said, when we went to Kuala Lumpur, we asked people, where's the Krishna temple? And so, of course, there's many Krishna temples. There's at least a few, you know. So I told him, no, you have to say Hare Krishna Tapo, not just Krishna Tapo. It's a little different. So in the same way, many people, they're worshippers of Lord Krishna, but they don't all follow Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, we consider that without going through Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, then we can never come to know Radha and Krishna. So the worship of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is preliminary to the worship of Radha and Krishna. We want to get the shelter, we want to understand the pastimes of Radha and Krishna, we need the blessings of Lord Chaitanya. But then, many people, they are followers of Lord Chaitanya, but they don't follow the teachings of Rupa Goswami. Now, Rupa Goswami was a direct disciple of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Therefore, his teachings, that the teachings which were given to Rupa Goswami, are very important. It is said that just as the heart of Brahma, Lord Brahma at the beginning of creation, was impregnated with the knowledge of the Vedas, so in the same way, Srila Rupa Goswami's heart was impregnated with the pastimes of Radha and Krishna. And Rupa Goswami could describe all of the pastimes of Radha and Krishna by the grace of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. It was Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu who enlightened the heart of Rupa Goswami so that he could describe all of this knowledge to us. So Rupa Goswami was, he had some brothers, particularly there was Sanatan Goswami, who was the elder brother of Rupa Goswami, and there was another brother also called Sri Balabha, but Sri Balabha was given the name Anupam by Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So there were several brothers, but these three are particularly important for us because they come into the pastimes of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So, Anupam was actually a devotee of Lord Ramachandra. And he could not worship Radha and Krishna. He could not give up the lotus feet of Lord Ramachandra. But this was not a fault on his part. It was his nature to be devotee to Lord Rama. And Lord Chaitanya accepted that Anupam had this mood. But at the same time, Anupam, while he was a devotee of Lord Ramachandra, he also accepted Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to be none different from his worshipful Lord Ramachandra. So he considered Lord Chaitanya, he understood Lord Chaitanya as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. For Anupam, the Supreme Lord was Lord Ramachandra. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, of course, is teaching the glories of Krishna, the position of Krishna. You might like to open it from Madhyalila, chapter 19. You can see chapter 19 in Chaitanya Charitamrita. Lord Chaitanya instructs Srila Rupa Goswami. So we were explaining, it's okay. Srila Rupa Goswami and Sanatana Goswami were both engaged in the service of the Nawab Hussain Shah. The Nawab Hussain Shah was a great governor of Bengal at that time. And Rupa Goswami and Sanatana Goswami were very respected leaders of the Brahmin community. Therefore, the Nawab Hussain Shah recruited them to his government and he gave them big positions in his ministry. And they became very intimately connected with the Nawab Hussain Shah and his Mohammedan government. So much so that although Rupa and Sanatan were born in Brahmana families, they were given names of Mohammedans. And they were called Dabirkas, that was the name of Rupa Goswami, and Sakara Malik was Sanatan Goswami. So Rupa Goswami was called Dabirkas, and Sanatan Sakara Malik. And Anupam, Tribhava, he was also called Malik. Malik meaning Mohammedans. They were given these names. And it was, these names were like an honor for him. And Sanatana Goswami had a very intimate relationship with the Nawab Hussain Shah. That the Nawab considered him to be like his younger brother. But it happened that both these three brothers, Rupa and Sanatan and Anupam, they had been receiving news about Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. They had heard about Lord Chaitanya, first of all, defeating Keshava Kashmiri. And that time Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was a young boy. And then they heard also about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu leading the disobedience movement against the Chankasi, and getting permission for all the people in Navadvip to perform Sankirtan. And then they had heard also how Lord Chaitanya had gone on to take sannyas at the age of 24 and gone off and left Navadvip and gone to reside in Jagannath Puri. And in Jagannath Puri he had converted Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya from impersonalism, from being a great logician and impersonalist, he had converted him into a devotee. So Rupa and Sanatan and Anupam had been getting all of this news. They'd been following all the activities of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And they were very attracted to him. So much so that they wrote letters to him. You can imagine in those days, there was no email, no mobile phones, there was not even a postal service. If you wanted to send a letter, you had to have somebody go and deliver it. They would go by horse or something. Anyway, somehow they managed to communicate with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and they expressed their great admiration for Lord Chaitanya and his mission, his teachings. So Lord Chaitanya was happy to receive their message and he sent messages back to them also. And eventually Lord Chaitanya came to the place where they were residing, which was in a village called Ramakeli. Ramakeli, it's in Bengal in district Malda. I think it's Bangladesh, not Bengal, not West Bengal, but East Bengal. So what is now Bangladesh. So they were living there, and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came there to meet them. Of course, when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came, so many people were following him, big crowds of people. So Rupa and Sanatan, they were Mohammedans. They had, you know, they were known as Mohammedan ministers in the government. So they were very careful and cautious about going to meet Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. They didn't want you know, the ordinary people would see them, because certainly they would think very unusual. They would think this very unusual. These Mohammedan men are going to meet this sannyasi. So they came when there were less people, very few people, and they met with Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And at that time, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu blessed them and requested them to give up their employment, their service in this Mohammedan government, and to come and join him. So, Rupa, he was the first one to get out of his service. And it is described that when he retired from his service, he'd accumulated a huge amount of wealth. It's said he had so much wealth, it filled two boats. And it is described that Rupa Goswami divided his wealth in a very exemplary manner. That he gave 50% of his wealth for the service of the Brahmanas and the Vaishnavas, or the Krishna conscious people. He gave 25% for family members, because he was a family man. He was not a sannyasi. He was initially a family man. But he was retiring from this family life, so he could not just simply go off and leave them with nothing. And he gave 25% of his accumulated wealth for the family. And he kept the remaining portion, about 25%, for his own emergency purposes. It's also stated that he gave 10,000 gold coins to a grocer there. A grocer in that place where they were residing. Because in those days there was no banks. You know, it's not like you could go to Nagara Bank and have an account there, you know. So there was no banks, but he gave the money to one grocer there. And it was understood, he had a good relationship with the grocer, that if there was some emergency, they would be able to use that money. So in this way, Rupa Goswami retired from his family life. He left. And he went off with his brother Anupam. The two of them went together. And actually they were waiting to hear news about Lord Chaitanya. Lord Chaitanya had told them that he would be going to Vrindavan. He was initially going to be in Jagannath Puri, but he would go to Vrindavan. So Rupa Goswami sent two men to go and find out, when is Lord Chaitanya going to Vrindavan? Has he gone yet? And so he sent two men, and then these two men came back and said, Lord Chaitanya has already gone to Vrindavan. He's already left Jagannath Puri. So when Rupa Goswami got this news, then he, along with Anupam, they left their home. And they also went to look for Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And they went first, they went to Vrindavan, and when they first went to Vrindavan, they were not able to meet Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, but they met a very nice devotee named Subhuti Rai. Subhuti Rai had been, you know, he was also Bengali, and he had come there to Vrindavan because, you know, there's a pastime about Subhuti Rai, how he was to be made into a Mohammedan. And he asked the Brahmanas, is there any way I can overcome this? And the Brahmanas told him, the only hope is that you have to drink boiling ghee. So drinking boiling ghee meant suicide. So Subhuti Rai, you know, he wasn't very eager to do that. But then he met Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told him, the proper atonement for this is to chant the holy name and serve the Vaishnavas. So Subhuti Rai was living in Vrindavan, and he would go around the forest of Vrindavan and collect dry firewood. And then he would bring it to the market and sell it. And with the money he made from selling the dry wood, he would make rice and yogurt, and he would feed it to all the Bengali people. Because the Bengali people would come to Vrindavan, they would not be happy. It's very difficult for them to eat braj rotis. You know, if you go to Vrindavan and you have to eat rotis all the time, it's not very good. You'll think, where's the rice? So Subhuti Rai would, he knew the Bengalis were having trouble like this, he would have yogurt and rice for them. And in this way he was living nicely, doing service for the Lord and the Vaishnavas. So Subhuti Rai met Rupa and Anupam, and he told them, no, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is not here, and he sent them to, they went to Prayag. They went to Prayag, and it was at Prayag that Rupa and Anupam were able to meet with Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had come to Prayag. Prayag means the place where the Ganga joins the Yamuna. Sometimes called Triveni. Initially there were three rivers, but the Sarasvati River is now underground. So anyway, Rupa and Anupam, they met Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu there at Prayag. And Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was very happy to receive them. And when they came before Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, they showed their great humility. They took straw between their teeth and they fell at the feet of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And it was at that time Rupa Goswami offered his prayer, Namo Mahabhadanaya Krishna Prema Pradayate Krishnaya Krishna Chaitanya Namani Gaur Tulashe Namaha. Rupa Goswami was appreciating Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, that he was actually Krishna himself who had come in the complexion of Srimati Radharani, and he was distributing love of Krishna to everyone. So he described him as being the most merciful of all of the incarnations of Krishna. And so Rupa Goswami and Anupam, they were with Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and at that time a devotee named Bhava Acharya came to meet Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Now Bhava Acharya is known today as Mahaprabhu, and he is the Acharya in the Vishnu Swami Sampradaya. Actually, their line is not known as Vishnu Swami Sampradaya, it's more known as Pushti Marg. But they're very well known even today. They have many, many members, many devotees. And Balabhacharya was a very great devotee, and he wrote some important commentaries on Srimad Bhagavatam. He was a very learned person and a brahmana, high-class brahmana. So he met Lord Chaitanya, he could see Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and he was impressed, a young man in the renounced order of life. So Balabhacharya wanted to bring Lord Chaitanya across the Ganga, across the Yamuna to his home. Even if you go there today, I remember one time I went to Kumbh Mela. And when we were at Kumbh Mela, we went to visit this house, the house of Balabhacharya. It's a temple there now, and they have very nice worship going on, which is done by the followers of Balabhacharya. They have many temples. Actually, the deity of Srinathji is worshipped by the followers of Balabhacharya. The worship was given to the sun. Balabhacharya was not a sannyasi initially, he was a householder, and he had two sons, and one of his sons was given the responsibility to worship the deity of Srinathji. And that worship is going on today in Nathdwara. Anybody, if you go there to India, you can go and visit the deity of Srinathji. Actually, that deity was found by Madhavendra Puri on Govardhan Hill. That deity actually belongs to our sampradaya, but somehow in the course of time it was given over to Ballabha Acharya's family, and his family took up the worship. They're still worshipping the deity today. So this Ballabha Acharya came to meet Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and he brought Lord Chaitanya to his home. But to bring him to his home, they had to cross the Ganga. Actually, not the Ganga, they first of all, they crossed the Yamuna, because the Ganga and the Yamuna meet. So they took the boat across the Yamuna. But when Lord Chaitanya was in the boat, when he saw the black color of the Yamuna water, the shiny black color of the Yamuna, then his love for Krishna was awakened. And he began to feel ecstatic love for Krishna. And he stood up and shouted, and then he threw himself into the Ganga. He threw himself into the Yamuna, rather. And all the devotees were all worried, oh my God, what's going on? You know, Lord Chaitanya jumped into the Ganga, into the Yamuna. He thought it was Krishna. He was seeing Krishna there in the Yamuna. So he threw himself into the Yamuna. And the devotees, of course, they were desperate. They had to struggle to bring him back into the boat. And when they brought him into the boat, he was still in so much ecstasy. His body was shaking. And the boat was, you know, was falling, almost capsizing. Water was coming into the boat. They were all very worried about their own safety. Lord Chaitanya was in so much ecstasy. So when Ballabha Acharya saw Lord Chaitanya in his ecstasy, he was astonished. He had never seen so much ecstatic love for the Lord. He was a learned scholar, and he knew great many scriptures, and he wrote wonderful books all about Lord Krishna, but he had never seen such ecstatic love ever as displayed by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So Lord Chaitanya then wanted to introduce Ballabha Acharya to these two brothers, Rupa and Anupa. But when Ballabha Acharya came to meet them, Rupa and Anupa, they moved away, they moved back. They said, no, no, don't touch us. We are fallen, we are from very low class. We are very contaminated and sinful people. If you come near us, you will be contaminated. You are a noble Brahmana. So Ballabha Acharya was shocked to see so much humility. But at the same time, he said, they say they're very low class and they're very fallen, but they're constantly chanting the holy name of the Lord. So this is certainly surprising. And Ballabha Acharya quoted the verse from Srimad Bhagavatam. Aho bhaktasva pachoto gariyam yasjivagre vartate namatubhyam tepastapaste susushnur sashnuraya brahmana chur nama grinanti yete. This is a very nice verse from Srimad Bhagavatam, from the teachings of Lord Kapila. It describes that, oh, how wonderful it is that a person is chanting the holy names of the Lord. That even though this person may not be high class, he may not be born in a noble family, he may not be a brahmana, but because he's chanting the holy names of the Lord, it's understood that in his previous lives, he had already acquired all the good qualities of the Aryans. He'd already visited all the holy places associated with the pastimes of the Lord. He'd already bathed in all the holy rivers. He'd already performed all the austerities and sacrifices. Otherwise, how else could he be able to chant the holy name? So, Ballabha Acharya quoted this verse, recognizing the spiritual position of Rupa and Anupa. And Lord Chaitanya was very pleased that Balabhacharya was appreciating, that birth is not the important thing. The important qualification is devotion for the Supreme Lord, and that devotion is manifest through the chanting of the holy name. So in this way, Lord Chaitanya was gradually preparing Rupa and Anupa. He brought Balabhacharya, then took them back across the river. This time he didn't go on the Yamuna. He thought, if I bring him on the Yamuna, because the Yamuna water is very dark, like Krishna. Ganga water is very clear, different color. So he took him across the Ganga. Next. And they came across the Ganga, and Lord Chaitanya then went to the temple of Bindu Madhava. And it was there at the temple of Bindu Madhava, Lord Chaitanya instructed Rupa Goswami in the science of devotional service for 10 days. For 10 days continuously, Lord Chaitanya was instructing Rupa Goswami. So these instructions to Rupa Goswami are significant in our Krishna consciousness movement. Lord Chaitanya began by explaining to him the rareness of devotional service. How it is very rare that a person becomes qualified to receive the seed of devotion. And he describes how there are so many living entities, so many countless numbers of living entities. And among all these living entities, there's only a few human beings. And among human beings, there's only a few who are pious or who have any interest in the Vedic culture. And of those who are interested in the Vedic culture, hardly there's anyone who understands the value of bhakti yoga, devotional service. So then Lord Chaitanya went on to describe how the fortunate soul receives the seed of devotion from the spiritual master. And when the seed of devotion is planted into the heart, then that seed has to be watered through the process of Shravanam and Kirtan, Vishnu. The devotees of the Lord have to nourish that creeper of devotion. They have to water it regularly. They must be very careful to chant without offense. And Lord Chaitanya went on to enumerate the different offenses which are there in chanting the holy name. And particularly, he warned how a devotee of Krishna must be very careful to deal nicely with the devotees. And certainly no one should ever think that they can commit sin on the strength of chanting. One may think that the power of the holy name is so great that they will utilize the power of the holy name to counteract their sins. So this is most offensive, Lord Chaitanya explained. Lord Chaitanya also explained the different anarthas which are there in the heart and which have to be removed in order to cultivate pure devotion for the Lord. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu mentions the different anarthas, like offenses in worship and chanting the holy name is one kind of offense, but there's also Vaishnava aparad, there's also deity aparad, seva aparad. In performing our worship, we may commit offenses, and we have to be very careful also not to have a material conception about devotional service. That we may be performing devotional service and at the same time keeping lots of material desires in our heart. So devotional service means to be free from these different anarthas, weeds which can strangle and choke the creeper of devotion. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then went on to describe the nature of pure love for Krishna. And particularly he spoke about the different rasas which are there between the Lord and his devotees. Of course, this is the subject matter of the nectar of devotion. Bhakti, ras, amrita sindhu, the science of the nectar of devotion. So Rupa Goswami was instructed in these different rasas directly from the mouth of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu described how the beginning of pure devotion comes at the level of shantaras, or the stage of neutrality, santaras. At this stage of santaras, the characteristic is that one is fully detached from all material desire. He has no material desire, no interest in material things, and he is fully attached to Krishna. This is the nature of Shantaras. However, at the stage of Shantaras, there's still some, there is not a direct relationship with the personality of Godhead. Because at the stage of Shantaras, one still has a conception of the Lord as impersonal Brahman or Paramatma. And one that is not able to absorb fully in the thought of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Because one is influenced somewhere, you see, Shantaras is between personalism and impersonalism. It's not fully impersonalism, but at the same time, it's not personal also. Therefore, in the stage of Shantaras, the Lord, the devotee does not engage in any service. He simply appreciates the greatness of Krishna. This is Shantaras. We simply think Krishna is very great, but we think of the greatness often in terms of his impersonal feature or his all-pervading Paramatma feature. So that at the stage of Shantaras, one is in this kind of level. It is not actually personal, but it's one of the five rasas. Then coming to the next stage, we have the stage of servitude or dasyaras. With dasyaras, the difference between shantaras and dasyaras is with dasyaras, the devotee is actually engaging in activities for the service of the Lord. But still, there is the mood of awe and reverence. There is no intimacy between the Lord and the devotees. One simply thinks of himself as a servant of the Lord. He wants to offer service. He wants to do service for the Lord. And of course there are many servants of the Lord. The Lord's servants in Vrindavan are Raktak and Patrak and Chitrak. And the Lord's servants in Dwarka are people like Daruka. And of course, and there are many other devotees like Hanuman also, who is a great servant of the Lord. So this is all dasyaras. Dasyaras means that there's not so much intimacy. We see Hanuman kneeling at the feet of Lord Rama. Very, very rare do we see Lord Rama embrace Hanuman. There's no intimacy. So this is dasyaras. But where there is less intimacy, then there is not so much, because there's no intimacy, it's not sweet. It's not a very, very sweet feeling. One is still influenced by awe and veneration or opulence. So this mood of opulence, it cripples the mood or the intimacy of loving devotion. To find the intimacy of pure loving devotion, we have to come to the higher rasas, Sakya and Vatsalya and Madhurya. We see on these three levels that there's much more intimacy between the Lord and the devotees. We see, for example, at the stage of Sakya Ras, that one thinks of Krishna as being equal to him. At the same time, the same mode of Shantaras is there, the two qualities which we mentioned, completely detached from all material desires and fully attached to Krishna, that is there. And the mode of Dasharas, giving service to the Lord, but along with that service, there's also the mode of friendship and intimacy. The devotee wants to be the friend, like the cowherd boy, Sudama, and Sridham, and Vrishabha, and so many other cowherd boys. They were all friends with Lord Krishna. And that friendship was part of their service to Lord Krishna. Lord Krishna enjoys playing with his friends. So these cowherd boys, they were in the mood of being Krishna's servant, they are also Krishna's friends. But then coming to the higher level, you have the mood of parenthood, Vatsalya Ras. We see Krishna's parents in Vrindavan, Ananda and Yashoda, and Krishna's parents in Mathura and Dwarka, or Vasudev and Devaki. And then others also enjoy parental relationships with Krishna. There are different parents like Krishna's nurses and so on. So on that mode of being in the mood of parental ras, then one can even chastise Krishna. Nanda Maharaj sometimes chastises Krishna. My child is very naughty. He's always doing mischief. And Mother Yashoda, of course, she will tie up Krishna. So this mood is there, the mood of wanting to maintain Krishna. They're actually in the mood of being a parent, just like those of you who are parents, you're always thinking about the maintenance of your child. You're always thinking what my child needs. So this daughter of mine, I have to get this for her. She needs new shoes. She's not well. Mother's always thinking about the maintenance of her child. So this mood is there also in Krishna consciousness. But Nanda and Yashoda, Vasudeva and Devaki, they're also thinking about how to maintain Krishna. They have to feed Krishna. So this is, of course, higher level of state. Nanda Maharaj and Mother Yashoda, they enjoy a much higher level than Vasudeva and Devaki. Vasudeva and Devaki, their relationship is often crippled by seeing the Lord as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Just like when Krishna killed Kamsa, then Vasudeva and Devaki were released from Kamsa's prison house. And when they saw that Krishna killed Kamsa, they could understand Krishna must be the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And they couldn't think of him as their son anymore. They could only see him as God. But Nanda Maharaj and Mother Yashoda, they only see Krishna as their child. Even when Mother Yashoda looks into her child's mouth and sees so many universes, she just thinks, oh, I must be seeing things. It can't be right. And when Krishna holds up Govardhan Hill, she thinks, oh, Krishna didn't do it. My son didn't do it. It must have been my husband. Like this, Mother Yashoda can only think of Krishna as her child. So she can enjoy that pure parental relationship. And then on the highest stage is Madhurya Ras. And we find this Madhurya Ras exhibited by, of course, the gopis in Vrindavan, as well as Krishna's queens in Dwarka, and the goddesses of fortune, Vaikuntha. that they all enjoyed Madhurya Ras in relationship with Krishna. And on the level of Madhurya Ras, then they simply want to satisfy Krishna. Everything is done for his pleasure. And all of their different loving exchanges is simply for Krishna's pleasure, not for their own pleasure, but they're simply engaging in whatever will please Krishna. So in this way, Rupa Goswami was told by directly from the mouth of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu all of these different rasas, and he was asked to write books and describe these things for all of us. And that's why we have books like The Nectar of Devotion. It's by the grace of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his teachings to Rupa Goswami. Okay? So we will stop here and ask if there's any questions. Any comment from anyone? Well, the books of the Goswamis, I've never heard that many are hidden or lost, actually. Generally, if you go to like Vrindavan Institute, there's a library there, and they have some of the original writings of the Goswamis. They have, you know, palm leaves, which have with the original handwriting of the Goswamis. So generally the books are available. It took some time. I know Bhaktivinoda Thakur, when he wanted to get a copy of the Chaitanya Charitamrita, it took him some time to find a copy. Not easy. Because, of course, in times of the Goswamis, everything had to be handwritten. You wanted a copy of the Bhagavatam, it had to be handwritten. And after Lord Chaitanya disappeared from the world, then the writings of the Goswamis were sent from Vrindavan over to Bengal, but on the way, they were stolen. Everything was stolen. And they had to look for them, they had to find them all again, and it was Srinivasacharya who managed to find out the king who his people had stolen them, and they recovered them. So generally the books of the Goswamis are available, but we should understand that not all of the books of the Goswamis are particularly suitable for us. Just like there was one book which Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati had read, written by Raghunath Das Goswami, and he said, "I like this book very much, I think we should print it." So Bhaktivinoda Thakur said, "Yes, you can print one copy for yourself." Because he said, apart from you, nobody else is qualified to understand it. So this is often the situation with the writings of the Goswamis, that it is not so easy for us to enter into their writings and to understand them so well. Therefore encouraged to read Srila Prabhupada's books very carefully. We want to know the Goswamis, you can know them through Srila Prabhupada's books. Prabhupada has given us the cream of the writings of the Goswamis in the form of the Chaitanya Charitamrita. It's the most philosophical, poetic and scholarly description of the pastimes of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And Srila Prabhupada has also given us the comments of the Acharyas in his Srimad Bhagavatam. When we read the Srimad Bhagavatam, any relevant comments which are there from the Sandarbhas, Srila Prabhupada usually includes them in his own writing. We won't find very much missing If you simply study Srila Prabhupada's books fully, then we will know everything practically of importance which is contained in the teachings of the Goswamis. So we shouldn't feel like we're missing something. Sometimes people feel, oh, Prabhupada didn't give us everything, or there's something, some the important things of the Goswamis are missing. We have to make use of what we've got. Huh? I was quoting Tamal Krishna Goswami in his writing. He was saying that the problem is it's not that we're lacking anything. He said we've got too much. He said there's so much. Prabhupada taught so much. He wrote so much. He spoke so much. There's so much information there. We have to make proper use of it. Don't feel that, oh, we didn't get enough. We didn't get it. Okay. Hare Krishna. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki. Some prasad up here for Hare Krishna, I'm not giving it.
Hare Krishna,
Prabhu. Hare Krishna.